let's give you some more information about how to deal with chaos. Okay. Can you hear me? Yes? Okay.
Recording in progress.
Okay. Yesterday, we discussed a little bit. Where's the razor? Is the okay. Yesterday we discussed the stability theory. So the definition, stability theory of dynamical systems. Okay. First, the definition by Lyapunov of asymptotic and simple stability. Do you remember you have to fix the ball and you see if your motion remains localized into the ball around the fixed point. Then we discuss the linear stability, so Lyapunov. Okay. Then we discuss on my screen. There is no. Click on this one. Okay, sorry, on the main. Okay, thank you. Then we discuss the Lyapunov definition, the linear stability analysis. Okay, linear stability. That amounts to diagonalized the stability matrix of your dynamical systems, finding eigenvalues, finding eigenvector, and discuss the position of your eigenvalues into the complex plane. And depending on the position, you can decide if a fixed point is stable or unstable. And the eigenvectors, as I told you, define the direction of approaching of or going far away from the fixed point. But the story wasn't, the linear stability doesn't finish the story. In fact, we also discussed the nonlinear stability. Because nonlinear stability, because in certain conditions, the nonlinear stability can change the scenario given by the linear stability, okay? And also, we discuss how from a fixed point, around the fixed point, you can have what is called limit cycles, okay? I recall you that this important notion of limit cycle, the limit cycle should be unique. No, it's unique closed orbit, of course, no? The motion repeats along the orbits. And the question is that this orbit should be unique, okay? To make the difference with the case where you have elliptic points, so where you find a lots of closed trajectory around an elliptic point, okay? I would like to conclude briefly this part with two definitions that is important, especially if you read books and articles and papers on dynamical systems. Two notions, that is the okay, the concept of stable manifold and unstable manifold. Suppose that you have the dynamics defined by the flow or a map around your fixed point. Okay? If you stay here, no, you can go you remain in the fixed point. But now consider that if you start far away from the fixed point, you can arrive or escape from the fixed point, no? So you can define two limiting sets. Limiting sets means they have to introduce the concept of limit, so they are invariant in some sense. When in this kind of mathematics you say an invariant set, it means that you stay there forever. It means that you can take the limit of the dynamics, and the dynamics still remains on that manifold. Okay, this is its concept of limit set. So we can define two limiting sets. One is the stable manifold, so the set of the phase space that in the limit of the flow, you arrive to the fixed point. Okay, for example, the stable manifold, suppose you have a fixed point like this, a saddle, okay? Suppose you have a saddle, sorry. The stable manifold is the manifold which arrives all the points of this set, which sooner or later, or even in the limit, infinite limit, arrive at the fixed point, okay? The way around, you can define the unstable manifold. The unstable manifold, instead, is the set of phase space, of point of phase space, that in the limit t minus infinity goes away, no? And this is the unstable manifold, for example. The set made by all these points along this line. So there are two stable, in this case, you have two stable manifolds and two stable manifolds, for example. And these are the unstable manifolds, okay? It's very simple. So, in fact, the unstable manifold is the state running away from the fixed point. As I told you, the stable manifold are invariant set. And if you stay on a manifold, you will stay on a stable or unstable manifold. We remain there forever, okay? So if it's like a prison. If you stay here, you can go away, of course, but you remain on that set. The important things of these two notions, stable and stable manifold, comes from the fact that so why is it important? Because consider that fixed point, manifold, invariant and fixed point plus invariant and stable and fixed point and their invariant manifold form the so-called skeleton of a dynamical landscape. What's the meaning of that? I need the eraser is here, sorry. What's the meaning of that? The meaning is that your local stability, your linear stability is only local, as I told you, no? It works around the fixed point. But there is the possibility that you have, so several scenario, for example. And there is also the possibility that one unstable manifold or one fixed point arrives to the other fixed point, okay? Becomes the stable manifold of the other. And also this. So imagine that the landscape of the dynamical system can be considered like a map where there are cities that are fixed points. Or fixed point, stable, yes, fixed point. There are the cities, city one, city two, and so on. CT3, okay? And the roads for going, the preferential roads for going from the highways, from going from one city to the other, so one fixed point to the other, are the stable and unstable manifold. So it's a concept that gives you the global idea. So you have, with the linear stability, you have local idea of your phase space, no? Phase portrait. But if you consider, if you study the behavior of a stable and unstable manifold, you can have a global vision, a global visualization of your landscape, of your dynamical landscape. The other things, for example, important that this is the, for example, the scenario that you can have for the pendulum. This is the unstable manifold that becomes a stable manifold of the other fixed point, and so on. So you have this kind of scenario, but you have also this scenario which is related to the damped pendulum. No, since this is the unstable manifold which runs to the fixed point, and the other, this unstable manifold is attracted to the fixed, to the fixed point, the stable fixed point, and so on. This is the unstable manifold. You see that there are some interesting concepts around the stable and unstable manifold. It's the fact that the saddle point, first of all, at the core of the unstable dynamics, of the chaotic dynamics, the complex dynamics of your system. What I mean? What do I mean? It means that if I have to look some chaotic behavior or strange behavior, I have to look the behavior of your system around the saddles. Here, potentially, in potential, there could be some interesting behavior, okay, near the saddles, first of all. And so, even is important the behavior of stable, of the stable and unstable manifold of the saddle, okay? If chaos, if you don't know about the system, if you want to search for chaos, is it better to stay near the saddle, okay? All attractors lie on unstable manifolds, okay? This is another properties. If you want to find some strange attractor, maybe it is around and is an effect of unstable manifold, okay? And stable manifold also, instead, so this is the properties of unstable manifold, but the stable manifold also has important, is an important properties because define the Bayesian boundaries of the attracting set, no? In this case, for example, you can separate the different kind of motion. In this case, for example, you can separate they separate this attracting point from, and you see, if you take the other attracting point, they are divided by the stable manifold. So the stable manifold defines the Bayesian boundaries. This is another concept that you have to take note of that, okay? Of course, there is also the possibility, and it's called homoclinic, that an unstable manifold goes to the other fixed point and becomes, so there is this possibility, unstable manifold becomes then a stable manifold, and this is called homoclinic intersection of the fixed point. Another interesting concept that you have to take in mind, to be in mind when we deal with the chaotic dynamical systems. Okay, I finished this, the last part, and I will start. I would like to start with the other one. Okay, lecture 4, I would say. Yes, example of chaotic behaviors. Share screen. I share my screen. Okay, maybe. Okay, now in this lecture, I briefly would like to discuss some examples to see how chaos is working. And I will discuss three typical standard systems, historical, I would say historical systems, the logistic map, the Lorentz model, which is the logistic map is a map introducing the concept of mathematical ecology. The Lorentz model is a simplification of thermal convection in atmosphere physics. And the anonymized model is an Hamiltonian system introduced to model the motion of a star into a galaxy. Okay? I would like to discuss these three. And I think we conclude the lectures with the... Okay, logistic map. Logistic map comes from the population biology. The first model of population biology is due to Malthus, introduced this equation of evolution for a population, for the individual of a population. The problem of this equation, of course, is that the number of individuals in the population grows forever. And this is impossible, of course, no? It's unphysical, it's unbiological. So Verhulst, instead in the 1838, introduced a modification of this model by introducing a term which stops the infinite growth of the population. And it's called, in fact, introduced the concept of carrying capacity. So the environment cannot support, any real environment cannot support the growth, the infinite growth of a population. And in fact, they introduced the concept of logistic growth. No? It's okay. This is a typical behavior of a population, very simple behavior of a population. Okay? So the population grows until these terms comes into play, comes into account, which stops. So we renormalize the growth. Okay, it's very simple. I think you have seen this object many times. From the point of view of chaos, this model, the continuous model, is very unusual because of course trivial because it's a one-dimensional continuous time system, and for, as I told you, for one-dimensional according to the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem, you can't have chaos in one or two dimensions. Okay, only fixed point or limit cycles. But the interesting things, of course, if you take the discretized version of the logistic map. And I wrote it. The discretized version is written here, so you have just to. X t plus 1 is equal to R, a parameter, x of t multiplied 1 minus x of t. Okay? And this is the logistic map. It's a one-dimensional map. And it's interesting because, for some parameter R, it develops a very complex behavior, so complex that Ulam, one of the mathematicians, the ancient mathematician, who also worked in chaos and in ergodic theory, decided to use this map as a random number generator for the values r equal to 4. Okay, he proposed to use this map, the random behavior of this map, as a pseudo-random number generator. Okay. You can study, for example, I suggest to you to see this review by Robert May, Sir Robert May, in 76. And this is a very, very nice review on the logistic growth. I suggest you, I invite you to read this very nice review. Okay, the logistic map has to fix a point, of course. I remember that the fixed point is obtained by, for a map, is obtained by studying the equation. Okay, x star. And you can study the stability by considering the derivative of the map, the modulus of the derivative around the fixed point. In this case, you have 2 and r minus 2. And you can study the behavior of the map at varying the parameter r is a control parameter. So study the behavior of the map of logistic map at varying control parameter r. Okay? Now, suppose that r is now, let me write the map. So this is the unitary square. Okay. 0, 1, 0, 1. You have this is the bisecting line, of course. And suppose that you start with r less than 1. If you start with r less than 1, you see that there is only one admittable fixed point, that is 0, no? And you can see this by making, for example, either by studying the stability, of course, but also if you iterate the map starting from a given point, and the iteration is a procedure, you take your initial point, you arrived at your function, no? And then you move to the bisecting line, and then you iterate the procedure, you go again from this point onto the curve, you move toward the bisecting line, and so on. In fact, this procedure is very simple to see that goes toward to zero. So zero is the only stable fixed point. Okay. With r minus than 1. Now, increase r in the interval 1 and 3. Okay. Now, what happens? The bisecting line intercept your curve. Okay. So another fixed point appears. Okay, another fixed point appears. And this point is stable. And it's stable, you can see, either by iterating the map. In fact, you arrive ortho. But also making the analysis, the stability analysis. No? In fact, okay, the fixed point, this becomes unstable. If r is in this interval, r is positive, so the zero fixed point becomes unstable, while the other has a slope that is less than 1, so is stable. In fact, if you iterate, you see that the iteration procedure gives you this behavior, brings you to the point, to the fixed point. Okay? Something new happens, very interesting. If your parameter, your control parameter, is greater than 3, equal or greater than 3, okay? In fact, if you make the iteration, you see that something new happens. You see that there is an oscillation behavior. It means, what does it mean, the oscillation behavior? That there is a limit cycle of period 2, okay? So there is a bifurcation, I would say, no? From a stable fixed point into a limit cycle of period 2. The fact that the map is very simple, can you explain analytically why this happens? In fact, thanks to the simplicity of the logistic map, you can extend the linear stability analysis to the period 2 orbit. And the period 2 orbit is the stable points of the second iterate of the logistic map. What does it mean? It means that. Okay. Okay, if this one, this is the second iteration means that you have to replace this object, xt plus 1, is this object with the map. So you have to substitute this with, again, r x 1 minus x. But also in this term, you have to substitute r x 1 minus x. OK? Of course, that depends on t, but it's boring for me. OK, I replace x with the first iteration. OK? It's clear? It's OK? This is a polynomial of second. Of course, I have to study the fixed point, of course, of this equation. Okay, to study the stability, and if I do this computation that is quite simple, it's algebra, it's simple algebra, you see that the 4-degree polynomial, that 4-degree polynomial, admits 4 roots. This one has the old stable points, of course, no? They survive, of course, no? Because if survives at an iterate, they survive also at the second iterate, because they are fixed point, of course. But there appears two new fixed point that becomes stable. And you see here what happens. This is the second iteration of your map, so that polynomial, basically. You see, if you intersect if you intersect them with the bisecting line, you see that there are two stable fixed points that are those, and the others and this one is this one, becomes unstable because the slope is larger than one, and also, sorry, but I have to.
Okay, I would like to switch it off.
Okay, sorry. And so, two new fixed point appears. What does it mean? It means that you have these two new fixed point, and the motion way around between them. So you have the motion is x, you arrive at x3, for example, after some transient, you arrive, x3 is mapped onto x4, x4 is mapped to x3, x3 is mapped to x4, and so on. Okay? And this is a period 2 orbit, of course. And this is the nice things that this bifurcation, so the behavior from one fixed point to two fixed point, occurs at the values of R3. So at R3, in fact, x3 coincide with x4 and coincide with x2, x2, but x2 you don't see it, no? You see that at r equal 3, you see that one fixed point becomes unstable and two new fixed points occur, but these two fixed points, the behavior of this of your map oscillate between these two fixed points, no? Way around. But this is not the end of the story, of course, because there is a lot of bifurcations. Hmm? The bifurcation from R3, you have the bifurcation of period 2. Period 2 remains stable until these values R2. From R2 to another point R3, you have a period 4. And then you have a sequence of bifurcations. So, in the, for example, in this range of Rk and Rk plus 1, you have a period 2k. Hmm? The change, of course, of stability is not bifurcation, but I think we have already defined it. Okay? The cascade of, this is called a cascade of bifurcation. No? Cascade of bifurcation. So, there is a sequence of bifurcation, and here you see the table. No? This is the period of the of your orbit. This is the this is the number of bifurcation, the index of the bifurcation. This is the period of your bifurcation, no? This is n equal to 1, you have period 2 and at the point r2 where you have this value, you have n equal to 2, so you have a period 4, for example. Then we have a period 8, and so on. And this is the number of the bifurcation point, okay? Where the bifurcation occurs. The values of the parameter are where this bifurcation occurs. This is delta. This is delta, this is a parameter. That's the difference between bifurcating points, two next bifurcating points divided by the previous bifurcating point, the distance between two bifurcating points, divided by the distance of the previous bifurcating point. Okay. And this quantity is important because it seems to converge. In fact, you see this table, it seems to converge to some value, okay? Here, I see there is a picture of the bifurcating point. For example, you have this one. This is the fixed point. The double, you have the period doubling, of course. Then you have another, you split in four. So period, this is a period four. And then and so on, and you go to the set of period doubling, the succession of period doublings. The important thing of period doubling is that, of course, the sequence has a limit that is called Fagenbaum constant. You can prove it very rigorously. This sequence has a limit. Fagenbaum in 1975 highlighted some intriguing properties of the period doubling, the universality of the period doubling. And of course, he defined this quantity, no? Okay. And this is considered the first Fagenbaum constant, the ratio converges to, so the succession of bifurcating point converges to this point. But if you make this ratio, the ratio converges to this quantity that is called the first Fagenbaum constant, okay? But there are another universal feature of, there is another universal feature of the bifurcating, the period doubling bifurcation. If you consider this quantity, for example, this quantity, this is the line 1/2, and you consider this segment, and you construct from this one half another segment, and you consider this segment, and so on. So you consider this set of successive segments. You see that even in this case, you have a you have a limit. So, no, the ratio of these segments converge to another quantity that is called second Feigenbaum constant. So, the value is one half. This value of one half is called the superstable orbit. It is important, but okay, the one half. The definition one half for this quantity is called superstable orbit, but you can find in every textbook. It's an important concept, but not so. It's a way to define this this quantity. Alpha and delta are universal constants, no? Characterizing the period doubling cascade for all quadratic unimodal maps. And this is the proof of Feigenbaum. He uses a normalization group for doing that. And he says that logistic map, but any maps which locally has a maximum, suppose another map, but the condition that this map should have a single maximum, unimodal, it's called ununimodal. This is bimodal, no? This is the bimodal. No. Of course not. For all this class of map, through the normalization group analysis, Feigenbaum was able to prove that this scenario, this number, this scenario is universal, and these numbers are universal. Okay? Which is delta n? Delta n is this. Delta n is this segment. So it's you take a line one half, the superstable orbit. This is called the superstable orbits. You take this line and you consider the length of this segment. You can define the length of this segment at every bifurcation point. And so if you take the ratio of these segments, the next segment with the previous one, okay, the sequence of these values, the ratio converges to this universal quantity that is called second Feigenbaum constant. Is okay?
Professor?
Yeah?
So if we do this procedure for every unimodal map, we obtain those numbers?
Yes.
Those ratios?
Yes. Exactly. And it's a computation of renormalization group. It's a universal characteristic of unimodal maps. Every unimodal map has these numbers. Okay? Thank you. Again, universality, okay. It's not, so the universality is larger than the, okay, but you can have also period doubling in ordinary differential equation system, so continuous time systems, and probably because under the behavior of these systems there is a hidden structure that is the Rator map. It's like similar to the if the motion, no, if you take the Rator map or for example Poincaré map and you obtain a unimodal map, probably you fall in the universality class of Feigenbaum scenario. And so in some cases there is also the possibility to have this value, the same values for ordinary differential equation, continuous time systems. There is of course another universal scenario that you can obtain with maps with non-quadratic maximum, like this. This is a typical, this is a cusp, no? Also for this, you can prove something that is similar to Feigenbaum scenarios, but now the values of the parameter alpha and delta depends on z. So these maps are like this, with a cups, as cusps. Also for this, you can prove something like Feigenbaum approach. And you see there are two, or again, the constant alpha and delta, but this universal constant may depend on z, only on z. OK? I think I finished this part. Ah, no. This is the bifurcation plot of the map, of the logistic map. You see, no? There is period doubling behavior, you see, no? This period doubling stops at the values of Feigenbaum, at the Feigenbaum constant, no? And you see that after that, the maps behaves a complex behavior, a chaotic behavior, no? This chaotic behavior is interrupted by stability windows, in which Feigenbaum scenario maybe replicates, and so on. And this is the typical object that is obtained. To have this this object, you have to iterate your map, discard a transient, and after this transient, you plot here all the state visited by your map. Okay? You change R, and then you discard the transient, and you plot again the state visited by your map. And you get this nice picture. Okay? It is called the bifurcation diagram. On the web, you can find a huge amount of picture, very fancy. And finally, I will discuss the behavior of the map at the Ulam point, R equal to 4, where chaos appears, okay? And you see, for example, that the behavior of the map becomes very unpredictable, very strange, at R equal to 4. It's called the Ulam point. No stable periodic orbits exist, no more. Trajectory looks random, and there is no more periodicity, of course. Okay? There is no more periodicity. Actually, what happens? Actually, there is an infinite set of unstable periodic orbits, of infinite, even of infinite period. Okay? You have a lot of unstable periodic orbits. So your system goes from one periodic orbit to jump to the other R because this is unstable, and jump and jump and jump till to arrive to periodic orbit of infinite period. Okay? And what is interesting that if you look at this picture, I don't see if you can appreciate it, but this picture. In this graph, there are two trajectories, starting from a very nearby initial condition. So you have a one trajectory. You make a small error, and you change the initial condition by a small amount, and you iterate the map. So you have two initial conditions that initially started very near. After some while, no. You see that until here you are unable to distinguish the trajectory, but after some point you can see that they are microscopically different. Okay? And this is the problem. This is exactly the effect of sensitive dependence on initial condition, one of the signature, one of the landmark of chaos. Okay? And Vulpiani, next week, show you how to characterize these this characteristic that I write on a sensitive dependence on initial condition. This is the typical and typical signature of chaotic systems. Sooner or later, two trajectory will diverge, starting nearby, very, very close. Sooner or later, they start to diverge, like this. But since the system is bounded, this divergence can last forever. But sooner or later, you have to, these curves must bend. And this, but if they come close, they diverge again, and so on. No? And this is the origin of the complex behavior of chaotic system. The continuous stretching and folding. Stretching is this one. They stretch, so they stretch this. No, they are stretched because the distance is increased. But sooner or later, you have to fold your trajectory back because the system is finite, and you come back. And then you diverge again, and so on. And this is mix your trajectory in a very complex way, very unpredictable way. OK. I think we can stop here and just relax for a while. Next model, chaotic model, will be the Lorentz model. OK? If you want, you can have some relax. You're dabbling. Wow.
Are monotonically increasing functions considered as unimodal maps? And if so, will these also exhibit the Feigenbaum constants? Okay, the guy, I think I found the answer, but maybe you want to add something.
Okay, the answer now, yes, maybe this, the answer is that I make some. The Feigenbaum scenario means that your map, your unimodal map, okay, at certain point arrive to R infinity, okay, you have increased your unimodal map to value in which you have an infinite behavior of bifurcation. So consider that R changed the height of your map, no? But it remains a unimodal map, no? So you have to increase R. There is a set of these values of the control parameter until you arrive at the values R infinity. It is called Feigenbaum point, where there is an infinite period. Orbit. Okay. I don't know if I replied. Moving R, you are moving the height of course of the map. You are changing the map until to arrive at the Feigenbaum point. Okay, Feigenbaum limit. Is that correct?
You said yes.
And Michele?
Then there is another question. Are there examples of universality classes where going beyond the linear renormalization group analysis show bifurcations?
It's not linear renormalization group analysis. It's a renormalization group analysis because you have to, okay, I have to enter in details, but you have a flow, you have, so you have to construct So in your normalization group analysis, what you do? You make a change of your map, and you try to fix the fixed point of your changing of your maps, no? And this is but this is not linear, and linear non-linear processes, no? You have to construct a class of maps depending on a parameter, of course, and you have to search a fixed point. The fixed point develops universality properties, okay? But it's a fixed point of the functions, not of the state. So you are trying to change the functions. Another way you try to make a transformation of your function. In such a way that you have a certain point unimodal shape, basically, no? And when you arrive to the fixed point, you linearize around the fixed point, and you see that the Feigenbaum scenario appears. Any other question? Okay. It's okay? Can I go on? Okay. The other system that I want to discuss, it's a continuous time system, and it's called we have finished with this. Okay, sorry. I skipped this. Okay, the other system that I have to rush because otherwise I can finish the lecture. The other system that I would like to discuss is the Lorentz model, introduced by the very famous meteorologist Lorentz in 1963. And Lorentz investigated, this is called Rayleigh-Binard convection in the atmosphere. Basically, the physics of this problem is that. Suppose you have a hot plate, a fluid, and a cold plate on top, okay? And the hot plate can simplify, for example, the presence of land of ocean, no? The heat, the air, no? And this cold plate may represent for example the higher layers of the atmosphere that are very cold, okay? So you have, for example, and the question is how the fluid behaves in these two, between these two sources of the hot source and the cold source, okay. Basically, what you have, of course, you have that the upper plate is colder, no, and the lower plate is colder than the lower plate. So buoyancy, no. So the fluid here is hotter, so is also with lower density and goes up onto the cold layer. Okay, and you see this type of behavior. But this tendency is contrasted by viscous and dissipative force. In any way, a conduction state occurs. So you have, for example, the transport of heat from the hot through the fluid from the hot plate to the colder plate. Okay, and this is the conduction state. But if you increase the temperature, the different temperature between these two plates, what happens? That the conduction state is no more stable, and a new state counter-rotating vortices appears. So what happens if the temperature is enough? So the hot fluid goes up, no? But the colder it reaches the colder state and becomes heavier and goes down. And this behavior starts to give rise to rolls or rotating counter-rotating vortices. Okay, there is a not conduction but convection behavior. No, so the fluid starts moving, making rolls. Okay. If you increase just a little bit the temperature between hot and cold plate, you have that this state is no more stable, and something that is very unpredictable, since the motion is very strange, you see that the behavior of the fluid is no more so simple. Okay. To model this behavior, Lorentz make a very crude approximation of this phenomenology. He expanded the Rayleigh-Bernard convection partial differential equation, because of course it's a problem of partial differential equation, into a three dimension into Fourier modes, and then he retains in this expansion the only three first modes, hoping that in this process the best part of, so the main part of the phenomenology could be preserved. Okay, in fact Lorentz wrote, and this is the equation that Lorentz wrote, where xx is the intensity of convection, okay, y is the temperature difference between the two plates, okay, and z instead is the deviation of the temperature from the linear profile, because if you have a simple conduction, of course you have a profile, a simple temperature profile from a simple temperature profile from the hot is here, and so this is the length of the plate, the length of the distance between the plates. So you have a simple temperature profile in conduction state, and the deviation from this profile define the variable z. Okay. Sigma R and B are dimensionless positive constant. Sigma is considered the Prandtl number. It basically is the ratio of the fluid viscosity and the thermal diffusivity. So thermal, basically there are the two physical phenomena entering in this model. Okay. And R is a renormalized temperature difference, and is a control parameter basically. So it's the delta T, the parameter that the R is related to delta T is your control parameter. Basically, is proportional to delta T, the difference between the temperature of the two plates. And B instead is a geometrical factor explaining that the fact your geometry is the one that I show you. Okay. This model you can use, of course, you can study the linear stability analysis of the Lorentz model. And you see first of all that this model is dissipative. In fact, the divergence of the field is negative because sigma b are positive, and so the phase space volumes are uniformly contracted. So it means that you start from a three-dimensional space, but you arrive in something that is no more three-dimensional space. Basically, is something that is related to two-dimensional, for example. Or okay. So your volume, you're arriving on an attractor that is no more three-dimensional, okay? The fixed point are, of course, obtained by this equation, and there are, if you make the computation, there are zero is a fixed point, and there are these two stable fixed points. R0 is the state of conduction, so the first plot, the conduction, is the fact that you have a transmission of heat from the hotter to the colder, to the colder plate, so only conduction. And instead, R star plus minus are the two clockwise anticlockwise rotation of the convective rolls. No? If you remember this plot, at a certain point you see that there are rolls. And there are two possibilities of rolls, two rotation state, of course, clockwise and counterclockwise. Okay? It's quite simple. Questions on that? No, for the moment. And then you can study, of course, the bifurcation, as we did for the map, the logistic map. We can do the bifurcation behavior. Oh, in this case, it's not so simple, but it's okay. But there are some features, for example. For the R, of course, R is the control parameter. I use R as the control parameter, okay? R is my control parameter. I fix the other, and I study the behavior of your system by varying R. Okay? At varying R, we can have different scenarios, of course. For example, if R is from zero, is in zero, between zero and one, you have that the convection state is stable. The conduction state is stable. Okay. And the other two fixed points are complex. So you can see the convection state. You only see the conduction state. Okay. But if R start becoming greater than one, what you said that R0 loses the stability as one eigenvalues becomes zero, larger than zero. And the other two fixed points become stable. So conduction becomes unstable, and is replaced by the convection. So two rotating rolls appear, okay, two. Okay, several rotating rolls appears basically. In this range of parameter, the eigenvalues part of the of R of these two start to becoming composite conjugate, but the steady convection remains stable. Okay. R star plus minus remain stable. At a certain point, for R larger than this critical value that is defined by this quantity, even the steady convection state, so these two fixed points, becomes unstable. Okay, as something new appears. What appears? Okay. Sorry. Okay. It appears something that is very strange, because you see that the attractor, the motion is attracted by this very simple, very complex behavior, and it's called the Lorentz attractor. Okay, you see that this is the values at which the Lorentz attractor appears, basically, and of course is above the critical value RC, that above RC, RC is this value. If you make the computation, if you put eight thirds, you obtain of course this value. No, if you stay beyond these values, and this R is 28, you observe this behavior, this attractor. Okay. And what we see, for example, we can do two numerical experiments. In this case, you have to study the behavior of your system by numerical analysis, numerical integration of the equation of motion. No, what you observe? Okay, you observe that, for example, if you start from two initial conditions that are far apart, they, after some transient, are attracted on this strange geometrical object, the Lorentz attractor. But if you take two initial conditions that are very close, you see that, for example, these two trajectories again start nearby, and after a while, for example, time of 15, they become different. Hmm? And the way this happens is if you plot the difference in time between these two trajectories, now you see that this error between these two trajectories is small, start increasing linearly, and then saturate until these two trajectories rolls onto the attractor. Okay, and this is again the sensitive dependence of initial conditions, the signature of sensitive dependence of initial conditions. Okay, some questions. This is the fact that you remember that I told you that chaos generally appears if you look at the stable and unstable manifold of fixed points, of unstable fixed point. And in fact, if you're able to construct the stable and the unstable manifold of the fixed points, of the unstable fixed point, these are the two unstable fixed points, you see that the attractor lives there. Okay? The attractor. If you want to search the attractor stays in the unstable manifold. Okay? As we done for the standard map, for the logistic map, you can construct the bifurcation plot of the Lorentz attractor. For example, you have again the control parameter. You fix these values of the other parameters of the model. You find a numerical solution of, for example, for up to a time of 300 times 300 time steps, discarding of course a transient, and you plot R according to zeta max. For example, if you decided that your evolution has a behavior, you see that your evolution has a strange behavior like this. Z, if you take the z coordinate of your model, this is time. A trajectory of Z should be something like this. You take the maximum, okay? you plot all this maximum that you obtain in your trajectory after discarding a transient, and you see that you have this this typical plot where you have this is the stable fixed point, the bifurcation that I discussed at the beginning, and then after that bifurcation, you observe chaotic behavior. You see, even in this case, there could be some stability windows. So the system becomes stable again, because it becomes non-chaotic, and so on. And this is the typical bifurcation plot of Lorentz model. Okay. Okay, just this is the last slide about the Lorentz model. So we see that, for example, in this case you have that a separation of initial condition grows exponentially. No, in log-log plot you see that in log-log plot, sorry, that linear, this was a log-log plot, so maybe I did a bit. This is log-log plot. You see, this is log-linear plot, sorry. So this behavior is exponential because it's linear in log-linear plot. This is the separation of the trajectory is exponential. Okay? And this means that if you take two trajectories that start nearby at the beginning, you have the propagation of the error grows exponentially in time, okay? Till to reach the saturation, where the attractor, no, till this behavior stops when the two trajectory arrived on the attractor. Question? Ah, no, sorry. Okay. Okay, also Lorentz systems show erratic evolution of trajectory associated with sensitive dependent of initial condition. And the typical equation of the sensitive dependent of initial condition is this one, an exponential divergence of nearby trajectories. Okay? Another evidence of the chaotic behavior of the Lorentz map can be obtained by considering the Lorentz return map, the Lorentz system, the Lorentz model, can be constructed by using the Lorentz return map. Basically, Lorentz return map is this one. You have, for example, consider Z. Z is the behavior of the trajectory, the component Z of the trajectory. You see that you obtain the maximum. You take this maximum. If you plot this maxima, the maximum at time t, at time n, against the maximum at time n plus 1, you obtain this typical map. And if you see, this map is something that is a map which has an unstable behavior, okay? And this map is if you, for example, you are able to fit these two branches of the map with some analytic function, you see that this map develops chaotic behavior, okay? And this is another signature of the fact that the Lorentz attractor has a chaotic behavior, okay? The return map, this is called Lorentz return map, okay? And I finish the... In the slides there is also a derivation of the, but I don't have time to show how Lorentz derived the equation his model from of course this partial differential equation using the Fourier expansion and truncating the Fourier expansion to a given order, okay? To the lowest order, basically. Okay. The other system that I would like to discuss is the last system that I would like to discuss is the Hannon-Hiles systems. It's another historical model, and it is an Hamiltonian system, and that due to the conservative dynamic and symplectic structure, you remember that Hamiltonian systems are symplectic systems, you remember, and you know now by now you know what the meaning is. You see that okay. The question is how chaos manifests in Hamiltonian systems. The model was motivated, physically motivated by the fact that Hannon-Hiles wanted to study how a star was moving around a galaxy center with axial symmetrical symmetry. And the question they want to investigate through this model is if there is another integral of motion except the energy and the angular momentum. The angular momentum due to the fact that we are rotating in a galaxy, okay? So the question is there any integral of motion except energy because the system is conservative? The angular momentum due to the fact that there is a symmetry, of course. So the question is, because they want to understand if this possible integral, no, this possible constant of motion was able to restrict the motion of your trajectories. So, if you move on an energy surface, you are constrained by your energy conservation, of course. You move your system moves in the hypersurface of energy conservation. If there is an angular momentum, there is another constraint on your motion. So there is another intersection of the energy surface with the surface of defined by the angular momentum conservation. If there will be another integral of motion, there are intersection of three surfaces, okay? So the question, they wanted to answer this question. The model is very simple, so you have this, a particle moving, this is the, in a two-dimensional, the system has 2 degrees of freedom. Hmm? This is the potential is written like this, okay? And if you start to make the analysis of this model, you have...
Fabio, sorry, may I ask a question on this? So they constructed this model enforcing a third...
No, they are asking if there is a hidden okay. Symmetry, the another symmetry, so that a new constant of motion appeared. Okay. So. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Actually, for example, the star explores a three-dimensional constant energy surface in four-dimensional space. No, the first constraint is this one. And of course, not only all this surface is explored, but this part is explored because if you have the energy that is if you discard, for example, you have an inequality, of course. So not only the surface, the energy surface is explored by your system, of course. No, there is a subset of the surface explored by the star. So the original question, if no other isolating integral of motion exists, the above region, this one, of non-zero volume, of course, because it's a surface in a phase space, a four-dimensional space, of course, will be filled by a single trajectory of the star. So what you have, this this set, and this set will be filled, no? You have this set. Suppose that this set is a portion of the of your surface, no? If there is an another integral of motion, maybe you have some, again, some limitation. But if you don't have any integral of motion, now the trajectory should wander in your surface like this. Okay, you could explore every part of this subsurface. Okay? And so what you can do, of course, it's a three-dimensional. Now you have four-dimensional system. The constraint of energy conservation reduces the dimension of your system to three. But of course, even in three-dimensional, it's very, very difficult to see the motion, to describe the motion. What you do? You make the Poincaré section. And the Poincaré section that you want to construct is the Poincaré section where x is equal to zero and p of x is positive. So the intersection comes from the positive p of x, okay? I count only the intersection with positive p of x. In this way, a four-dimensional phase space is reduced a two-dimensional phase space, okay? Of course, this is the advantage of Poincaré section. Before analyzing the Poincaré section, it's better to say that Hannon Hall Hamiltonian is the sum, of course, of harmonic part, this is harmonic part, plus something that is an harmonic part. And this part plays the role of perturbation. This part is an integrable, system, no? So you can write this in terms of action angle variables. You remember yesterday I discussed you that when you have an integrable system, this is equivalent to the motion on a torus, okay? Because in the action variable representation, your dynamics lives on a tori, okay? So this is the part, the integral part, and this is the perturbation, okay? When, and you can consider, for example, this as a deviation from your integrability, okay? So you have a perturbed, basically a perturbed integrable system. If you make some analysis of your potential, you see that the potential has a very strange behavior, no? It's I don't know how to. It's can you see? Can you imagine from the picture? It's a well where there are three escaping possibilities, no? So they are subtle. You see that here there are the saddles, okay? And this is the fixed point, the stable fixed point. In fact, if you make the analysis, the fixed point analysis, you see that zero is a fixed point, but there is also this one and these two other ones. So the scheme of the distribution of the fixed point, this is the stable fixed point, and this is the saddles, okay? And the nice things is that these saddles at the values e equal to 1/6, you have that these saddles are connected by these lines that are triangles, that define the triangles when u is equal to 1/6. These are the equation of motion, of course, the Hamiltonian equation of motion that you can derive by deriving the Hamiltonian, no? Using the rule of the Hamilton equation. And now we have to study the Poincaré section. what you observe, so this is the Poincaré section. Now the section is at x equal to zero at different values of a, deviation from the integrability. Different values of e means that you have deviation from the integrability. And okay, you have to p of x, the initial condition of p of x is given by this one, but the constraint of the energy conservation. If you integrate your equation of motion, you see that two different scenarios can be possible. This trajectory, you see this is a torus, this is a torus, no? Okay, this torus intersects your section, Poincaré section, x equal to zero, giving rise to this kind of plot, and this means that the motion is this a signature of the motion? What kind of motion is?
Periodic,
exactly, periodic motion. But, of course, if you change the initial conditions, so maybe you change, I don't remember how did I obtain this plot, but maybe I changed the initial condition, no, the energy, because, no, sorry, in fact, sorry. This is the integrable condition. But if I increase the energy, of course, I run into a non-integrable initial condition. In fact, you have the appearance of chaotic behaviors. In fact, the intersection with the Poincaré section is very random, okay? And this is a signature of the fact that that values of the energy, the values of energy, I remember that is the deviation for the integrability, basically. The higher is the energy, the higher is the deviation from integrability. If you increase the energy, you see that your Poincaré section is this one, okay? You can do this for several values of energy, for example, three. You can use three values of energy. This for divided by 12, for example. And you see that the motion basically is stable, no? Because you have closed orbits, no? Generally, closed orbit in Poincaré section are stable trajectories, as I showed you in the plot before. And so there are very clear, but you see that here near the saddles, you see that something happens. No, in fact, you see that these curves are thicker. Same thicker. If you zoom, for example, this point, you see that some signature of chaos appears. And in fact, chaos appears where there is saddles. No? Saddles in the Poincaré. This is saddles in the Poincaré section, not saddles in the original model. Be careful. In fact, they intersect. You know, you should understand that this is a map because the plot intersect. Because in the real space, so you can have crossing of the trajectories, no? Because according to the existence and uniqueness theorem, you can't have crossing of trajectories. Otherwise, you violated the deterministic nature of your system. Okay. Because I repeat this. This is an important statement. Existence and uniqueness and existence theorem says that you can have crossing of trajectory because if you move here, if you arrive at here at this point, following the flow. Then what you have to do? You can go this way or this way, but this is a violation of the determinism. No, there are two futures, not one future. Okay, but this is not true for maps. No, this is not true for maps. In fact, in Poincaré maps, you have crossing you have crossing in Poincaré maps, no? Okay? Now, if you increase, for example, the energy a little bit, you see that there are islands, so there are even periodic solutions still survive, but the sea, the chaotic sea, start increase, no? So there are lots of randomly distributed points, so the intersection with the plane start become random. And you see, so there are island plus the coexistence of stable trajectories plus chaotic trajectories. If you again increase the energy, so you move away from the integrability, you see that there are lots of chaotic trajectories, chaotic points, and only few stable trajectories. Okay, and this is why, and this is how chaos in Hamiltonian models appears. Okay. And the fact that you have this picture answer to the question that there is no another integral of motion. In fact, your trajectory wandering on the allowed phase space. Okay? And there I conclude. I think I concluded this part. Thank you. Thank you. It has been a pleasure. It has been a pleasure for me. And I hope to be, I was comprehensible as, okay. I try.